Welcome back to Modern Education. I am your host, Benjamin S. Woodford, here in the studio. And I am so excited to have another guest here with us for another live show right down in the basement of Memorial Auditorium here on the Stanford University campus. It is Friday and it is 3 o'clock, and we come here every week Friday from 3 to 4 p.m. for your commute. You can always text us at 855-723-9010 if you want to get through. You can also call, although I may not answer it because we have a guest and I'm super excited to talk with her. So definitely you can hit us up on the Twitters at KZSU or at KZSU DJ. We always love for you to find us on social media. We are on Facebook and Instagram, the Instagram, and the Twitter as well. So look us up at Modern Education, or you can find me on the website, MrWoodford.com. So I got my co-host back on the... Hey, Emily, how are you this week?
I'm doing well. How are you?
You know, I am like feeling so pumped right now about doing another radio show.
Oh yeah. Every Friday we are here ready.
And we're talking about education, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That is what we do. We talk about modern education, which means a little bit of learning, a little bit of fun, a little bit of personal development, a whole bunch of cool guests. And we are going to bring our guest this week on the microphone. Our guest this week is Felicia Darling. She's a PhD working at the Santa Rosa Junior College and a graduate here from Stanford University. And she's got a new book coming out, which we are excited to talk about. And we're going to kind of break down some barriers around this book. The book is called Teachin' It, Breakout Moves That Break Down Barriers for Community College Students. And I think it's going to be a lot of fun. So we got Felicia on the mic here.
I'm
hey, Felicia.
To have you here, Felicia. Hi.
How are you guys doing? Oh my God, Emily and Ben are so adorable. I know you guys are on radio, so you can't know how awesome they are. And you're not getting the full physical effect here, but so happy to be here with you guys because you guys are adorable and brilliant. And you have awesome show as well.
So. Well, Felicia, you know, you are our first returning guest here at Modern Education.
She's our MVP.
So you have you have sort of a special place in history of the Modern Education
again,
show.
Next book, I'm coming back again.
Okay, well then you can be our first triple visit to Modern Education, and that will come with a free door prize. I just haven't figured out what the door prize is yet. Emily, make a note of that.
Chocolate
door prize for the first triple trifecta visitor for our show. Okay, so Felicia, we got our book to talk about, and we're going to talk about your book. But first, let's talk about you a little bit.
Oh.
Yeah, I want to hear a little bit. I want to hear a little bit.
A little specific.
I'll take you there, Felicia. Okay. I want you to think a little bit about how you got into wanting to do this equitable teaching thing. What is the thing that inspired you to even want to write a book or to do all the work it takes to get in the position where you're at? Is there I know it's a series of events and there's a lot of different things that got you there, but is there something that stands out in your mind that sort of pushed you to realize this was important to you?
Mm. Yeah, I think as a kid, I always cared a little bit about fairness. Mm-hmm. But as someone who was brought up in poverty to some degree as an adult anyway, and as a first generation college student, I always felt a little, you know, at Stanford, graduate school, wherever, a little like I didn't belong. And so I wrote the book to kind of help students. One of the goals is to help students who are maybe students of color, students with disabilities, students who are non-native English speakers, first generation college students, students who didn't feel like they belong on campus, to help them to kind of feel like they belong on campus. And so I guess maybe I had those experiences and I saw, you know, my friends, other students of color, you know, being subjected to kind of larger systemic discrimination. And I thought, I can't change this larger systemic problem, but I think with a book, maybe I can help teachers to disrupt some of this unfairness, some of this inequity at the classroom level. So I think in a way I've been writing this book, as I say in the book, for 30 years. I'm going to do something. I don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm going to do something maybe to change this systemic discrimination and you know, I can't change poverty. I can't change the declining social mobility in the country. But maybe, just maybe, I can pull enough things together in a book that can help instructors disrupt some of these systemic inequities at the classroom level.
Yeah, and that's so true and possible too, because classroom is its own sort of microclimate, right? Mm-hmm. And well, everything that happens in that classroom is constructed, co-constructed by the social interactions and the teacher's sort of motivations and the student's presence and all these other things. And I really love the part that you mentioned, and you also mentioned this in the book, which I thought was really interesting, the bringing yourself into your work and realizing, like, you didn't start out day one when you started writing the book, but you're bringing your past and your thoughts and your experiences. And you recommend this in the book too, that as a teacher or a facilitator of learning that's coming into the classroom, they actually need to bring themselves and really understand their own personal style and value.
It's highly personal.
Right. Yeah. Right. And I just love that point. And I love how you brought it up again here, because it is such an important part. We're not a blank slate. It's not tabula rasa as soon as you start your first day in the classroom, right? You are bringing in a lifetime of experience, and that should speak to what you value and what's important to you.
Right.
And it sounds like you're pushing to try to live the things that you experienced in a way that can put you back.
And I think in the book, because the majority of college instructors are maybe middle class and white, mm-hmm. maybe they don't have the same experiences I've had to identify with people who've been othered. But that's part of the book. I try to bring to life some of these students' stories in the book so mm-hmm. people can lean in and go, oh, you know, this is what some of my students are going through. When I had that student who was formerly incarcerated, maybe that's what they were going through. So I try to add some pieces where to help instructors develop a little empathy and help them to have some tools to mentor students who are maybe from backgrounds that are radically different than their own.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now go ahead.
I mean, I imagine like in a classroom setting where you are, well, semester based, where you are always getting new students, that it's so easy to just tag a student by a number rather than it's their name. And one of the points that you brought out that I found really like nice and refreshing to hear, just the simple bit of calling a student by their name and remembering
getting
their name.
Getting it right.
Yeah.
You mentioned that in the book too. And I thought, like, it's so easy to say I try to remember my students' names and still not have them all by the end of the quarter or semester. Mm-hmm. But it's more than just trying to remember their names. It's actually learning it and getting it right. And, you know, that's something that matters, right? You're showing a human quality that you actually appreciate, that they matter enough to learn their name.
Yeah, I'm not going to swear because I know that's a violation. I really, part of me feels like, it's really important to remember students' names, and it was really hard for me to do it. In fact, I interviewed some instructors, Carlos Valencia and Dan Munton, who you had as an instructor.
I did.
That's exciting. I interviewed them on the Teachin It YouTube channel, and they explained how they memorize students' names, because I actually had a fixed mindset about that. I'd given up on that years ago. I'm bad with names.
Yeah, I hear that all the time. Yeah,
but I worked so hard. Not a swear.
Yeah.
Two semesters ago, and to develop the strategies to learn students' names, and it transformed my classes. It was just amazing. Right away after the first day, they were calling me Felicia, and they're doing the Bye Felicia from Friday's thing.
Uh-huh.
And they knew each other's names, because I had said every student's name at least once, and some people's names, I wanted to really pronounce them, so they've heard them five times, so everybody knows how to pronounce everybody's name, probably more so than I did after the first class. And at the end of that first semester, when I added this new strategy of memorizing students' names, at the end, I had students high-fiving me, hugging me, crying when they left. I'm like, what happened? We are so close now as a community of learners, just because I don't want anyone to think that that's the only strategy
it's not just
to
the
use
names.
For
yeah,
community of learners, but it was a strategy I had missed, and it was a high-leverage strategy with all the other high-impact strategies I was using to build the capacity for a community of learners and to create a safe environment. And I just can't believe how different my classes are now.
Yeah. And it's such a powerful tool. I agree. I mean, and it shouldn't even be thought of as a tool, right? Is it a powerful way to bond with people and show them they matter?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that's a worthwhile framing of this. I know when I was a high school teacher, you know, I'd get a new 150 students at the beginning of the year, and I would tell them all, I don't want name tags. I don't want you to make this easy for me. I want you sitting somewhere different every day for the first week.
Give the challenge.
And I will have all your names down by the end of the week.
Wow.
And that was my goal. And I made it really hard for myself on purpose, because it made me cognitively work for that and actually think about it. And I didn't hold back about asking for their names as many times as I needed to. But usually within that first week, I had everybody's names down, and wow, they knew that it mattered. Yeah. And it is the exact same thing you described. It was a learned process of actually formally teaching myself how to remember names, mm-hmm, and how to tag it and create, you know, patterns to actually remember people's names. And it makes a difference. You know, I've gone to a professional development before and went around and kind of like chatted with everybody real quick before the professional development. And then I was able to call every single person by name during the workshop.
Wow.
And it makes a huge difference. It really matters. And not to mention also, it's very impressive. And I don't know why. It shouldn't be that impressive. It's just like a memory trick, just like anything else. Anybody could learn to do it.
It's a lot. I think it's a lot of work. It was a lot of work for me. It was kind of exhausting for me because I'd already given up, thought I couldn't do it. And I implemented those specific strategies. And it was a cognitively demanding task for me the first time. Now, like you said, I'm just better at it. Although I don't do it at workshops still. I mean, not that those people don't matter. Everybody matters, but my students matter so much. That I just worked. I was willing to do that hard work for them.
Right, and I think I'm just extending it. I've realized, like, I agree with you as far as like my students were number one, and I wanted to do something that showed them. But I've started to extend it to my entire life. I think it's important to remember people's names. I write down almost every single name that I ever get and put a couple notes about why and how I met them. And it's important. I have a catalog going back years.
I've heard that it's stories, like associating them with a specific thing that the person did, is at least to connect, to draw back to your memory. Oh, so like Adam is the one on the left side of the classroom who highlights with an orange highlighter. I don't know.
A little something meaningful.
You guys have pushed me. I'm going to get my comfort zone again and do it more in regular life.
There you go. Wow. Look at that. Teaching the teacher.
What's your name again? Emily, right?
There you go.
Yeah. It's good. Okay. So let's dive into the book a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. What do you say like are the top three or top two things that you would hope people would walk away after reading this book?
Whoa, there's so much. I'm going to say the book is 206 pages and I jammed a lot in that.
Yeah.
It doesn't have everything people need to know to do inquiry-based group learning. It doesn't have everything people know to do.
That would be an encyclopedia.
Yeah. To do inclusive instruction or to build a community of learners or to teach spiraling college and career skills.
Right.
I mean, but I did kind of weave together the research and strategies and teacher stories, student stories to try to, you know, pull as many macro and micro ideas as I could. So there's a lot in that book. But your question is, what's your question?
What are like the top two, top three things? Like if somebody sat down and thoughtfully, meaningfully read your book, and I know there's a lot of like specific moves and things people could do so they could probably come back and reference it many times. Mm-hmm. But if they sat down, read it cover to cover and were taking notes, what would you hope that they would walk away or roll away or stroll away from that book with?
Well, I think they could walk away with 50 strategies they could use the next day in class. And so I tried to make it practical so they can walk away with that. You know, it's really kind of, because of the design of the book, people are going to walk away with different things. Some people are going to go, I can memorize students' names. Other people are going to go, wow, that's what systemic inequity is. Mm-hmm. Oh,
right.
That's what implicit bias is. Oh, I think I already do that stereotype move in class.
Right.
So one thing I really hope they walk away with, though, is that I frame fostering a growth mindset classroom in terms of an equity lens.
Mm.
And so I think a growth mindset, like any tool.
So let's break that down for a minute, okay? If someone's not familiar listening, what is growth mindset?
So,
and then we'll get to the equity lens.
So fostering a growth mindset classroom means you're focusing on mistakes or sources of learning. Taking risks is good in instruction. That someone who is good at math isn't someone who's really fast at math. It might be someone who takes a really long time, but they can continue to persist. So it's someone can make mistakes, learn from their mistakes, and persist. They don't think experts are people who are born that way. They don't think that ability and intelligence is a fixed trait. They think that it's something you can learn and get better at. Like me with the name. names. I had to, I had a fixed mindset with names. I can't do that. I'm not the kind of person that memorizes names. And I had to go, okay, I have to get a growth mindset and know that I can apply strategies and I can get better. That just because it's hard doesn't mean I can't do it. Hard just means I'm at the place where I'm going to learn the most. So that's really having a growth mindset.
Right. And so growth mindset is this concept brought up by Carol Dweck, right?
Dweck, of course.
And she loves the term yet, right? It's always thinking about yet. We're going to get there. We may just not be there yet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do you frame that with an equity lens? What's that? What does that mean differently for you?
So the danger that I'm seeing, like a lot of scholars are mentioning to me off cuff, like I presented at Berkeley, and they're like, ah, growth mindset. A lot of criticism is being cast at growth mindset because they're afraid that instructors are using it in a way to perpetuate systemic inequity. Like, oh, look at those poor kids. They have fixed mindsets. No wonder they can't do well. You know, it kind of becomes this way to perpetuate systemic inequity.
It's a very fixed way of looking at growth, right?
Yeah, instead of framing it in such a way that you just prevent that from happening in the classroom. Like, even the shift of my language from teaching a growth mindset, meaning that student has a fixed mindset, they're the problem, let's change that and get them to have a growth mindset. Instead, I talk about fostering a growth mindset classroom, which puts the responsibility back on the shoulders of the instructor.
Right.
It's like, I'm now responsible to create a safe environment where students feel comfortable taking risks, making mistakes, and sharing their unique perspectives, whether they're correct or incorrect. As you know, Jo Bowler, she's the gold standard for teaching growth mindset and inquiry-based collaborative learning in mathematics. She really set the standard there. And it's a very egalitarian approach. Everybody's voice is counted. You hear everyone's unique approach. You know, how did you do this? What's your reasoning? And it's not about correct or incorrect answer. It's about the process. Mm-hmm. And I tend to focus more on skills, like, oh, how are your skills doing in this area? And Joe tends to focus on the process. That's how she frames it, I think.
Sure.
So that's some ideas about growth mindset.
Yeah. I really want to dwell on this for a minute, because you said something that I find really interesting is the difference between teaching mindset versus fostering a growth mindset classroom or an environment, right? Mm-hmm. And I think this is, a lot of people would dismiss that, I think, as just a difference in language with the same meaning. And I think you're making a very clear distinction that there is a different meaning and the different language is important to use.
That's the shift to the equity mindset and
a powerful language.
So why, I mean, I agree that it is important the way we think about things are shaped by the language we use, but why do you find that to be such an important distinction to make?
Because if I, as an instructor, am going, I got to foster a growth mindset classroom, in a sense, I've just made a commitment to disrupting larger systemic inequities that exist outside of the classroom. Mm-hmm. As we know, the systems aren't fair for students of color, students with disabilities, students, non-native English speakers, first-generation college students. There's a lot of systemic inequities, systemic discrimination built into the system in our country. And so in the classroom, you got to take responsibility to make sure that's not what happens there, right? It's an equitable, inclusive classroom. And so when I say, if I say, oh, I'm going to teach them to have a fixed mindset, it's like there's something wrong with them. Whereas if I say I'm going to foster a growth mindset classroom, that gives students a lot of agency and autonomy to improvise and express and make mistakes and stumble and start over again, have first drafts. It creates an environment where they're really safe. It's really about safety.
Right.
As opposed to, you have a fixed mindset. It's kind of like, you're the problem.
Sure.
And it takes a responsibility, as we know, research by John Diamond shows that when there's discourse around blaming students and their backgrounds, the teacher has no agency. It's like, well, it's their fault. I can't do anything about that. Drop mic, leave the classroom, right?
Sure,
but this way, it's like, I'm going to create that environment. And if I fail these students, it's a big deal.
Well, I think sometimes like a lot of professors or instructors are just at least cultivate the idea of talent, like a born talent. Mm-hmm. And that if you don't, like it goes easily back to math. And like, if you're not good at math, then you're just not good at it. And you might be a really good writer. And maybe that's where your talent lies. And then you lack the side, or at least the instructor's push to like you're saying, facilitate that growth mindset rather than it just being fixed and like, okay, right. You're just not good at math. That's
just
it.
The way it is. And to bring up, let me just add
okay,
that.
Okay, yeah.
Joe Bowler and then some other study came up because you reminded me, Emily, that recent study, because it didn't have research that showed this until Joe Bowler came out with it and then this other study, who I forgot who it is. But they showed that when instructors have a growth mindset, students in their classroom do better and tend to have more of a growth mindset. And so what you're describing is an instructor with a fixed mindset about a subject. Mm-hmm. And so it makes sense that their students would respond to that and be demotivated. It's like, yeah, you either are or you aren't a good math person.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah. And there's studies that have also shown teachers who have trouble with math or self-image is tough. Mm-hmm. They transmit that to their students as well. And there's a lot of this sort of social interaction and social transmission that I think gets left out of the equation of what teaching really is. And so again, going back to your idea of fostering a growth-minded classroom, you are including yourself in that. You're not saying I'm the teacher, you're the students.
Like
the students
also am held to that standard.
Yeah, we are all here to learn. This is a classroom which I am part of, and we're all trying to learn together. And the other part I'm really interested about this, or I just want to kind of highlight for our listeners, is the difference between the deficit model and the asset model of thinking about people.
Yeah.
The classic psychology thing that is, you know, the DSM, Diagnostic Statistical Manual, is like the gold standard of psychological assessment. And it's all about deficits, what you have wrong with you.
Oh,
what is, you know, you have a problem and we're going to tell you what your problem is. Now, the more, I'd say, the more evolved and more recent way of looking at this is positive psychology, which really looks at the assets people have and say, wow, you are a great people person. Mm-hmm. That is an asset. We don't say, oh, you're bad at math, because that's just looking at your deficits and saying, oh, well, if we're dwelling on that, it makes it the focus, right?
Well, you could not have the math skills you're going to have yet, and you still need to build them up.
I
wouldn't want to pretend people are all, their skills are fine, but I agree with you about the deficit language, because, I mean, the whole idea of teaching it, and it's not just about math, even though we're getting on that subject.
Yeah.
It's about all subject areas. But it is an asset-based instructional model, which means the idea is to develop this inquiry-based group learning, this fostering a growth mindset classroom, spiraling in, layering in college and career skills in ways that dignify students, examining your own implicit biases. The idea is that you're giving students the opportunity to express their unique approaches in this environment in a safe way. So you're illuminating their individual assets and allowing them to link the learning to their prior cultural backgrounds or their individual backgrounds and prior knowledge. So it is a very asset-based approach, as you said, because that's the point. You're shining a light on who people really are.
Yeah, and the thing I think that's great about that is that everybody has assets, right? It's like we didn't all just wake up one day and become a student, right? We have an entire lifetime of assets and cultural capital and things that we can bring to the classroom.
Right.
And sadly, in a lot of classrooms, only certain cultural capital is valued, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so this equity lens, a lot of that is kind of honoring what people maybe bring into the class beforehand and realizing that's all still valid and it doesn't just kind of go out the window just because now you're a student, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. As Joe Bowler, I don't want to do math again, but because the book's not just about math, it's across all disciplines. But Joe Bowler talks about the math is not the authority. The teacher is not, the teacher's not the authority. The math is the authority, right?
Okay.
So it's like the subject material is what you're going to discover, you know, by co-constructing learning.
Sure. Right? So the ideas are taking center stage, right? And it's not about the teacher being the sage on the stage, being the dispenser of all knowledge, but it's in fact.
I think you saw in the book the flip top heads of the students, the behavioral model.
Sure.
The teacher's the dispenser of subjective knowledge, and students are rewarded with kibbles of approval for jumping through hoops and regurgitating what the teacher said.
Right,
that's not the Teachin It kind of model, right? That's the behavioral approach. And then the Teachin It model, the asset-based model, is students working together to co-construct knowledge with the instructor as expert facilitator.
Right.
It's a heck of a lot. No swearing. More work, though.
Yeah.
I mean, just going into like group work, as opposed to individual-based work is one way. And I found one that was really interesting is like facilitating where you have a full, like one group and the rest of the students watch how that group interacts.
Huh.
I found that interesting of just how to teamwork almost, like giving how do you say it? Like giving the life skills, like you're saying, how with when you're in school, in when you're in a job, like one of the most desirable qualities is being able to be a teamwork and a team worker.
Yeah.
And if you can't do that, in which I would say typically in schools, it's mostly just you, your assessment, your talent, again, what you can do.
Individualist view, which is prominent in American society. I want to just do a quick ID for everybody. This is Modern Education on KZSU. We're sitting down with Felicia Darling, who is talking about her new book, Teachin It, Breakout Moves That Break Down Barriers for Community College Students. So if you've just joined us, we hope you'll stick around as we continue to chat with Felicia Darling. And you can always text us 855-723-9011. Zero here at KZSU. Now, Felicia, I want to jump in to a next topic. And there was something in the book that I found, I think, a really cool way of thinking about feedback, and also something that I think a lot of people have a hard time with, which is this idea of giving like really honest and constructive feedback that doesn't sugarcoat it or sort of pat kids on the head and say they're a good boy, but actually honors that they are smart enough and capable enough to hear meaningful, constructive feedback that maybe isn't always just happy, but just clear and true. And you talked about this a lot in the book, or, you know, had a nice section where you gave some clear examples of the differences between these two things.
Are you talking about the Steele's Wise, three-tiered Wise?
I think so. Yeah.
Probing questions.
Right.
Probably the Steele's three-tiered Wise feedback.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So can you break down a little bit about your ideas around like what feedback should be doing? And I think more importantly, I know, and this is something maybe I dealt with, but I think other people have dealt with as well in the classroom, is like, it feels bad to sit someone down and tell them what's wrong with them. And I think at some level, sometimes it's hard to take that step and be like, hey, I trust you enough that you're going to not be offended by this because we have a good relationship and I'm here to try to help you. And I think there's maybe some perspective you can give us on
sure. There's a lot about feedback and praise in the book. A lot of it is about Carol Dweck's ideas about, you know, the perils of praise, her article, and the idea that you're not supposed to say you're brilliant, you're smart. That's fixed mindset feedback. But
wait, stop right there for a second. You're saying telling someone they're brilliant is not a good thing?
It's fixed mindset, because I'm saying you have this ability. I break it down slightly different than Joe and Carol, but I think it works for me. I shouldn't call it Carol by her first name. We're not on a first name basis. Professor Dweck, I'm not sure. But anyway, so I mean, you're brilliant, you're great at math. So if someone says to you, oh, look, I get an A in math, I'm smart at math, I'd be like, wow, you must have worked really hard to build the strategies and those skills.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell students who aren't good, one of the big things that happens in entry level classes is students come with very different background knowledge.
Sure.
And so I tell them that right up front. There's some students already know a topic, they're probably not going to have to work hard, they already know it. Someone else, you're going to have to work harder. You may have to spend 4 hours in the lab this week to learn that. Doesn't seem fair, but that's the way it is.
Right.
Tell them stories about my own self with my struggles in graduate school. But back to feedback and praise. So Carol Dweck's ideas, that you praise effort, not a fixed mindset, like you're really good at that, you're really bad at that. Mm-hmm. But also what's really important, and that's not Dweck's work, it is Dweck's work actually.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of comfort-oriented praise is very detrimental.
Yeah.
Because it really sends a secret message to people like, yeah, I don't think you can do it either. Maybe you're not good at math, maybe you're good at writing. Or the implicit agreement you have with some students where you don't call on them because you're like, oh, they're never going to be able to answer that, I just won't call on them. Instead of saying, tell you what, John, I'm going to come back to you for number 7. So you can work in your group, make sure you know that. You give them a warning ahead of time. So you're still holding them accountable, but maybe you're giving them a little more time to come to the answer.
Right. That's like Doug Lamov's move in the Teach Like a Champion, right? No opt out, he called it, right?
So comfort-oriented praise is not a good thing, right? And that's what you're talking about. People, I feel bad the student can't do this. What just came into your head? I feel bad the student can't do this.
It's
you
a belief
now believe
system.
That. And even if you did nothing, they would know you think that.
Right.
Students are very savvy, and so they know that. But I think one of the praise that I really like is Claude Steele's Wise Feedback. And I use that a lot in my classes. It's the idea that you give critical feedback. And you know Brian...
Brown?
Brian Brown. Yeah. I TA'd his class when I was here, and he modeled that for me. So I knew what that looked like in a writing rubric. Yeah, it's really wonderful to see. So basically you give, there's three tiers, right? The first tier is you give critical feedback like you normally would. Don't, you know, that's not quite right. Well, that problem's wrong. Oh, you got to do more of this in an essay. You didn't really nail this. So critical feedback you'd normally give. That's one piece.
Yeah.
Another piece is critical feedback. And then the second piece, why do I forget it all the time?
Because you're on the spot.
Critical feedback. The third piece is you have to communicate. Oh, yeah. Second piece is holding people to high standards. It's like, it's like, here's the critical feedback. And this is what you're expected to do. You're expected to write an essay that's college level and a transfer level essay. That's the tough love part.
Right.
This is what I expect everyone to do. I am holding you to this same high standard.
Right.
But those two things together aren't quite enough. You have to put that third piece, and I'm giving you this feedback because I actually believe that you can achieve these high standards. And they did a study on this with the three pieces, and they found that with two of them didn't work. You had to add that third piece, that I believe in you. And especially and if you just did the critical feedback with I believe in you, people thought, they didn't really trust it. They're like, they don't really believe you, right? So you really needed the third three pieces, especially for students of color. They noticed it really was more motivating because, you know, there's a history of mistrust maybe with authorities and systems that have let them down. So there's a lot of healing you have to do with students who've been subjected to discrimination, systems of discrimination, right? Because they're like, oh, she's probably just like everybody else. She's just like the rest of the world, right? So you got to like do things a little differently. And that's where the alleviating growth mindset interventions like the three-tiered feedback really are effective with students.
So let me break this down real quick. So you said there's three different tiers. The first is to give honest feedback.
Like you would normally, critical feedback.
Right. Yep. Honest, critical feedback that is actually trying intended to help them grow. Mm-hmm. The next is to let them know that there is a system-wide understanding in your classroom at the very least.
Expectations.
That you will hold everyone to these expectations. So it's not just them.
In high standards.
Right. And then the last is to let them know like a personal connection. You actually personally believe in them as a person.
Yeah, I believe you can achieve these standards.
Right, yeah. Right. So that's a powerful thing, right?
I throw a little growth mindset in there and I'm like, and I'm sure you will figure out the strategies that you'll need to figure out in order to continually improve. So I put a little bit of the skill building because I focus more on skills with the growth mindset feedback than, and maybe that's a form of focusing on the process that Carol Dweck talks about.
Right, right. That's really interesting. I remember, I'm remembering the first time I sat down trying to give some like really honest feedback to my students and I felt a little weird about it.
I could imagine.
But it got really easy after I started doing it for a little while. And I think that's kind of the thing is like all these new skills that we try to do. I mean, I sat down, you know, 150 students over 2 weeks and gave them one-on-one interviews for their final exam and really got to like look at their work and talk with them and actually like try to assess them in like a very personal way. And it was hard to look them in the face and be like, hey, you really screwed this up. But they really appreciated it and they came to learn to understand and trust. I think it's a little harder in college because you don't get to do this multiple times and kind of get past this. But at the same time, I mean, I think you've experienced and you're kind of explaining a bit about how you can actually create quite a culture in your classroom pretty quickly. And it doesn't matter if you only have them for one semester, if you're thoughtfully attempting to actually make these jumps and these efforts to show that you're serious about it, it matters.
I think your example is really interesting because this is what I hope the book does for people is that what you just described was really Claude Steele's three-tiered wise feedback. You don't have to specifically say to people, sometimes I do, I go, I believe you can do it. And I say that. But by spending the time that you spent, you actually communicated to them, I believe you can do it. There's an example in the book about Byron Reeves where someone spent 45 minutes with him. When a teacher invests 45 minutes with you, they basically said, I believe you can do it. Otherwise, I wouldn't have done that. So one of the interesting things about the book is people start just seeing what the research name is for something that they've been doing all along. And so like in your example, that's like Claude Steele's three-tiered wise feedback. And you can think to yourself, oh, it does have those three pieces. I need to make sure when I go forward that I always have those three pieces. So it's very affirming for people and really makes them go, oh, I do that, but it looks really different when I do it. It looks different in different subject areas. It looks different with different instructors because we're all completely different.
Well, yeah, and I think part of what you're describing is creating a way of having terminology and like a mental model to think about these things.
Yeah.
Because we do, I mean, most research, I would say, is some sort of formalizing of intuition and common knowledge at some level. And what we're doing in scholarly work is we're trying to formalize that and systematize it and really nail down the intricacies that are harder to tell through intuition.
And see if they work.
Right. So, yeah, exactly.
It's demonstrated that the three-tiered feedback works. And
right.
So I definitely want to try that in my class and try to catch the spirit of it, like as you said.
Yeah, and you may be doing something similar to that already, but having the terminology and the framework set up for you helps you conceptualize the parts.
Yeah, that's one of my goals for the book is that there's this shared, I know I interrupt a lot. I know people. Joe told me that one.
You're the guest, Felicia.
I can interrupt. Everyone here
is allowed to interrupt.
It's okay. That's one of my hopes for the book is, you know, I don't know if anybody knows, but you make nothing when you write a book. Joe, right? You make a dollar a book and the first 800, you make nothing. So I didn't do this for money.
Right.
I did this because I really want to get it.
I mean, you're not rich
hands.
And famous off this already?
No.
You should be. It was a fun book.
I wanted to get this in the hands of like at least 20,000 educators. So there'd be this shared knowledge. You know,
right.
I had this unique experience of teaching for 30 years, then going to 5 years at Stanford, then going back to teaching and trying those things. And that's a really unique experience. And so I was able to weave these things together in such a way that I think is really practical for instructors. And I think it's important, like you were saying about terminology, for instructors to have kind of a shared knowledge of ed psych theory, a shared knowledge of current research and academic mindsets, a shared knowledge about a lot of research and this book is one way to get that. And when you're teaching in K through 12, you kind of get that because you go through an education program. But when you teach at community college or a broad access college or even the university level, you frequently have a discipline specific degree. We all are in education, so we've got a lot of education courses. But there's a lot of people that have never seen ed psych theory, right? So
they
might be doing really solid things in class, teacher moves, and yet they're like, oh, that's why that's so powerful. I'm tapping into students' prior knowledge, or that's why my group work is so powerful, because I'm actually teaching to a lot of different zones of proximal development.
Right.
So it's really nice for, like you said, to have the terminology, the vocabulary, and the shared ideas. I think that helps make the teaching profession at the college level better, makes everybody better, because now they can say, oh, you did that three-tier. This is what it looks like in my class. Like, we're having this conversation right now in this community of practitioners, us, right? We're like, oh yeah, I do that, but it looks like this. Oh, I do that, but it looks like this. Do you think I need to do this? Am I really communicating that?
Yeah, and that shared language and that common vocabulary really allows those conversations to be more clear and direct. And that's kind of the power of language, is only as clear as the common understanding of the two people, both the speaker and receiver of that language, right?
Right.
And so what you're describing, this idea of that if teachers or professors have a common language, it allows that sort of rapport and repertoire sharing to be happening at a more direct and mutually understood level.
And the students benefit, right? I mean, that's my hope for this book, is I didn't write it for teachers necessarily. Mm-hmm. I mean, not that I don't care about them. I've been in education forever. But I really did it for students who might feel like they don't belong on campus, students who feel like outsiders, students who may be new at navigating the college culture in the college campus because they're first-generation college students, and students who might have more challenges to navigating college. And so my goal is to help teachers lean in, listen to students more, have more empathy, try some of these strategies to foster a real growth mindset classroom, foster an equity mindset, do more equity moves, all the strategies in the book, layer in college skills and career skills in ways that dignify students. I did that. I wrote the book because I think it can make a difference for students. I think it'd be a game changer, especially in California in light of the AB 705 law. I don't know if you know about that.
Yeah, can you fill us in a little bit about that? You mentioned it. And
that's a big one. So there's a big trend in California and really across the nation that too many students of color and students who've been historically left out among those, you know, who are underrepresented among those with four-year degrees, they've been kind of left out, right? So they're taking too long to transfer to a four-year university. They're taking too long to graduate, or they're dropping out. It's a big problem. And so what they've done is they're doing away with remedial courses in college. That's the AB 705. So in community college, that's it. It's over. No more remedial classes. Students will be placed in transfer-level courses with maybe a co-requisite. So no matter what their grade is, they'll be placed in a transfer-level course. course. Mm-hmm. They have that right, that freedom, and but that they might have a co-requisite course that goes with it. The problem is, I feel, is first of all, only quasi-experimental studies are done around this to show that this is a good idea. I think it is a good idea. We need to shorten that pathway. Students of color, students, first-generation college students, so students who lived in poverty shouldn't be marginalized and have to take longer. But the problem is, teaching is going to have to look differently if you are going to, you know, teach these diverse students with gaps, perhaps. Maybe they're underprepared. Maybe they have gaps in college skills or content skills. You're going to have to find a way to create this egalitarian approach that is not watered down, but instead denser instruction. And I feel like instructors are not prepared for that.
Well, that is commonly how it happens, right? We have a new mandate come down from on high, and then nobody pays the money or the time to train the teachers to be able to actually handle that. And then every teacher or every district or every school or university is sort of left to figure it out for themselves.
Yeah.
And that, I believe, is why it's so nice that there's people like you writing books like this.
Thank you.
Because it is taking the time and energy upon yourself, which as you've mentioned, and most people know, you're not getting rich off of the book. The book really is, I would say, a labor of love. I feel free to say that.
Yeah.
We're sitting down again with Felicia Darling. She is a professor at Santa Rosa Junior College, and she's got a book coming out soon. This is called, when's the date for the book? You don't know yet? It's coming
soon.
June 28th.
You told me two different things.
Okay, June-ish. Okay, and the book is called Teachin' It, Breakout Moves That Break Down Barriers for Community College Students. Huh?
Were we going to give away a free book?
Oh, we are. Yeah, we're going to.
I didn't want to forget about that.
Yeah, stick with us. If you've been listening this long, we are going to have somebody call in if you'd like to. Yeah. I mean, this is great content. You should definitely always stick around Fridays from 3 to 4 p.m. for Modern Education. But we will also be doing a book giveaway here at the top of the hour, right near the top of the hour, where you could call in and get a copy. And you'd get a release the day it comes out, right?
Yeah,
or it's close to it. Great. Now, okay. Now, your book actually has quite a bit of like different resources that I think are sort of intended to be on the ground. Like, here, you could actually try this in class tomorrow, or you could actually do this on your next assignment, right?
Yeah.
How do you imagine if I was, say, a teacher or professor that wants to take on some of these ideas, and I just bought your book, I have it in my hand, it's fresh and shiny, and I haven't marked it up yet or anything. How do you imagine you thought someone would work through it? Or what would be like the way to think about approaching your book and using it?
It's a little differentiated. So, for instance, if you don't know anything about growth mindset, I think you could get an introduction to growth mindset. And I like that I frame it. If you've never seen growth mindset, read the book, because I immediately frame it with an equity mindset. So equity lens. So I like that. So it just depends on where people are coming in. If you've never had Ed Psych Theory, you're going to read that. And it's going to become a reference book for you. If you've never
almost
seen
like a starting point.
It'll become a reference book. You'll go, wait a minute, what did she say about tapping into prior knowledge and zone of proximal development?
Right.
I mean, how many of my students? But the practices themselves can be just tried the next day. It helps that if you really understand why they're so powerful, right? And that's why I have the research behind them a little bit. But like, so for instance, the memorizing names, I just said, that's it, I'm going to do that. And I did that, you know, the semester after I found out about that. There's another, I think I have showing videos. Like, so for instance, I'm white. I call myself a blazer wearing white woman. And so.
you are actually wearing a blazer for folks at home.
My pajamas look like blazers. Hyping. I wear blazers all the time. It keeps me together.
There you go.
Anyway, so I look a certain way and I look white because I am white. And also I look like middle class, maybe, I hope. I hope I'm passing because of the blazers. But anyway, in class, I realized my students are students of color. So here's just an example of one strategy someone could just see and go, wait, I'm going to try that. So I show videos when I sometimes for instruction to supplement instruction of people who are radically different than me. One is, what's his name? He's a guru, some sort of math guru. He's African-American from the South, big beard, wears t-shirts, bald head, and big Southern accent. And he shows, you know, and I show the math videos. And I don't just show a math video because, oh, look, he's African-American, you guys. I'm like, I say, oh, look, he does this better than me. He does what I do. We're kindred spirits, because I can't give them, my students, an example of someone who looks like them. I'm not someone who looks like them. I mean, I swear a lot, as we mentioned earlier. So I don't swear
not on the radio.
I don't swear
in class.
never on the radio, but I tell them that, you know, and yeah. I can bond around some socioeconomic connections because a lot of my students have, you know, formerly incarcerated, had some challenges in life, have lower income just because of where I teach in the college system.
Right.
But I also want students to see videos of people who look like them, who are the authority in the classroom. That's one of the growth stereotype threat, kind of interventions that I do. And so that's just one thing someone could try. They could be like, oh, maybe I could show a video in my class and yeah. talk about the assets that this person has, you know, elevate them in the student's eyes so they know I think there are other people who look like them who also are quote unquote good at math.
What I find interesting about that is that in the media or in movies, for example, shows, things that we watch online, the growth right now is to demand more diversity. Mm-hmm. And that's essentially what you're bringing to the classroom, which yeah. for me, like at first when I thought that, like when I was introduced to that in the book, it does seem like a really, like such a small idea mm-hmm. that's like a video. It's easy mm-hmm. to do. But you really are bringing the world into your classroom just mm-hmm. by that simple example.
First, let me say, we know how old you are because you said watching TV online, watching movie and TV online.
Yeah.
Does everybody do that?
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out because I don't want people to walk away with a thin understanding. It's not about just showing, hey, look, here's a video that's has a Latinx student. Here's a video that has African-American. There's a process that I go through in the mm-hmm. book where yeah. I say, and this guy focuses on conceptual understanding just like me. Oh, and he mm-hmm. does this thing just like me. And he does this thing that I learned from him. So it's important that I'm showcasing it in a very specific way, not in a token way, but in yeah. like, this guy's an authority. In some ways, he knows more stuff than me. Some ways, we are exactly the same. So if you respect me, you respect him. So
right, yeah. right. You know, I think it's in Claude Steele's book, The Whistling Vivaldi.
Oh my He's God, talking. I just love that book.
Oh my gosh, I really love that book. But yeah. he talked about a study where they basically asked white or black students to just name like 8 people or 3 people that they were. That they knew that looked like them, that did well at something, that they like math, for instance.
We always come back to math.
Right. I can't help myself.
It's not about math, though. Let me just tell you.
Right, right. But the point was that this created a real problem for a lot of students of color and of different backgrounds other than being white middle class because they couldn't think of 8 people that were mathematicians, for instance, or 8 people that looked like them that were successful businessmen.
Was he doing that to trigger stereotypes?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's what
exactly.
I thought, yeah.
And so this idea of like bringing in voices and videos and images that you mm-hmm. are not tokenizing, but you're actually substantially looking at their work and appreciating for who they are and what they're contributing. I think that serves to start creating where there's more familiar faces that look like you or sound like you or that mm-hmm. maybe they don't. But you mm-hmm. can still identify that they are not the sort of dominant white male middle class mm-hmm. voice that is always... always privileged and always sort of the benchmark that everyone yeah. else is judged against. Mm-hmm. I mean, for instance, there's some work, some research on young kids showing that if you compare a little girl and say you can be just as good as a boy, you have already put them in a place where they are being subjected mm-hmm. to being as good as a boy. Mm-hmm. Whereas the reality is it shouldn't be, you can be just as good as a boy. It should be, you can be as good as you want to and maybe that boy can keep mm-hmm. up with you or something mm-hmm. else that doesn't frame it where you're right. being compared as the lesser.
It's very easy to trigger stereotype threat. I know we just lapsed into stereotype threat, but you probably read in the book that they gave people a test, like a GRE type test, and all they did was have a check mark about gender, a check right. mark about race, and that was enough to trigger stereotype.
And it was at the beginning of the
test,
right?
Of the test.
So the
yeah,
idea
yeah.
and the concept behind this is that the simple right. act
of putting yourself in
right. the simple act of being reminded which group you're in
yeah.
can essentially make you try to act in ways that either confirm or avoid or somehow change your cognitive ability during that process because you've been reminded of this. In fact, I just wrote a paper about this. Yeah. This is like really fresh to me right now, but it's like being reminded about how much you are supposed to fit or not fit the stereotype puts you in a place where your brain is focusing on a different strategy or a different focus, right?
Hijacking that part.
Yeah, so it could be an amygdala hijack where you're actually going into a fear state, mm-hmm. which is rightly so the thing you should be feeling when you're in a social situation being threatened in some way. And even those slight cues can act as threats that actually change where our cognitive focus is.
Yeah, and then in a way then, can you say that like stereotype threat is also attributing to the fixed mindset?
Oh, I'd say they're definitely connected. Yeah. In fact,
you want to be careful with stereotype threat though, because again, like fixed mindset, I noticed that the criticism is that sometimes people can start to blame again the person going through it. Like, see, there isn't really systemic discrimination. You're just all in your head. It's all in, you know, people of color's head, you know? It's a very important, again, to keep the focus around, creating a classroom. Like one of the interventions that alleviates stereotype threat is called an affirmation of affirm values, affirming values.
Value affirmation. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
They did it with seventh grade kids. They just gave them a 20-minute thing where they write down their core values. And through the process of doing that, it alleviated the achievement gap in those seventh grade classrooms for a couple of years, actually.
Right. So Cohen and Greg Walton's work on belonging, right?
Affirming values, right. And so I actually, in the book, I think probably one of the better things that I've come up with is, and I'd love to see research done on this, it's a drawing exercise I do to create an experience.
I read about mindset. That in the book, right. Tell us about it? We got a few minutes left, so this will have to be the last story.
This works in any classes. This works in English, math, whatever class, and I've done it with from fourth grade all the way up to superintendents. It works with everybody.
Okay.
I do in teacher professional development workshops, instructors do in education courses, English courses. I have students draw a picture of something that they got better at over time, right?
Right.
So I can't draw, right? But everyone can always draw something they feel passionate about, mm-hmm. right? So they draw something they put a lot of effort into getting better at over time. I say, this is where you have a growth mindset. And we use that as a springboard to generate strategies for what you do in math when you get stuck. So they draw this picture and they might draw soccer or fishing or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then I put on the board, what do you do? Sentence frames. What do you do when it gets challenging? What do you do when you make a mistake, and how do you get better at it? Right. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, so if you're playing soccer, comes up a lot. So if you're playing soccer, you kick the goal to the goal post. It doesn't go in. You just go, well, drop the mic. I guess I'm not good at soccer. Soccer's not for me. No,
I'm not a soccer person.
Yeah. They go, no, I don't do that. Cause this is an area they have a growth mindset in. They're like, right. No, we debrief and we scribe it, you know, like, no, I go and get help, or I practice more. I figure out what I did wrong and then fix that mistake. And I go, can you use these things in this class? Can you use these strategies in this class? Yeah, we can. And so it really helps students later on. I had a student later on. I'm like, hey, so what did you, he was struggling in math. And I said, well, what did you do at the first day? What did you pick for your growth mindset thing? He goes, I don't know. I go, well, what did you draw? And he goes, oh, I drew soccer, because they remember what they drew. Mm. And then he goes, oh, yeah, that's right. These are the strategies that I use. Well, can you use them now? Yeah, I'll try to use them. So that's like an activity that I do.
Right. So it sounds like the activity is kind of based around connecting something that someone's already worked through their growth mindset.
Somewhere where they have a growth mindset.
Something where they've developed. And this is an important piece, I think, and that's frequently misunderstood with growth mindset, is that nobody just has a growth mindset.
It's contextual.
Or just a fixed mindset.
Yeah, it's contextual, right?
Yeah, exactly. Right. So you may be growth-minded in soccer and mm-hmm. fixed-minded in math.
Yes, exactly.
And what you're trying to do is create a situation that sort of bridges that gap so that where someone started having a growth and an input and ability to improve, mm-hmm. you're showing them that same attitude and those same practices.
Same strategies. Relevant in math. Like, you know, do you just go, oh, I guess I'm not a soccer person? No, you don't. You go get help from someone. You go to a book. You Google it. That's a big thing that comes up now, right?
Right. And the other part, I'm going to pick on just a tiny bit on the drawing, because drawing won't work for everybody.
Oh.
There are 2% of the population.
It works for everybody.
2% of the population can't visualize things in their mind at all. So we got to leave out, there's a tiny amount of people people who would have trouble with that. Anyway, yeah. But either way, I think it's a really great strategy. And the sorry for picking a little bit.
Thanks a lot.
But I think we'll have better things to talk about. But the point is this: you're giving something to draw on that is more recallable or can be recalled more easily.
They don't remember what they said; they remember what they drew.
Right, and it's also allowing time for that.
Mm-hmm.
And you're actually saying, okay, maybe we're going to actually take 20, 30 minutes out of class use that. Right. And so you're taking the time, and I'm imagining your first class. Okay, there's 20 minutes that was in the drawing, maybe another 15 minutes over the whole class of you saying their names and repeating it and talking to them.
This happens, yeah.
Right. And so the thing is, I think a lot of teachers feel this pressure day one, dive into content because we only have 18 weeks and, blah, 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 blah. And I think kind of a meta piece of what you're describing with all these techniques and the psychology and the learning theories and all these other things and how important they are is taking the time to actually do things that create a learning environment.
Yeah. To launch the class. Yeah, skip the syllabus. They don't even remember that.
Send it home and have them read it or something, right?
Yeah, need to know basis, right?
Exactly. And it's like hand it out. It's a document that is, sort of a contract. Fine, you have to do it.
Yeah.
But putting your time into actually learning the students' names, understanding where they're coming from, finding out what they're good at, and that can pay off. I imagine you would have no qualms saying that will pay off for the entire semester or the entire year.
Yes, exactly.
And so you're sort of paying up front for the ability to have a powerful learning environment.
Right.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Dr. Felicia Darling is here on the Modern Education Show. She's been talking about Teachin' It, breakout moves that break down barriers for community college students. The book will be coming out in June, I believe, and we are actually going to give away a copy right now. So if anybody is listening and they would like to call in and get a copy of the book, we are going to take the first caller, 855-723-9010. That is Teachin' It, breakout moves that break down barriers for community college students.
What's the number again?
The number is 855-723-9010. Yeah.
One more time, because I talked while you were talking. One more time.
We would like you to call in if you would like a book, 855-723-9010. We got Emily out there in the studio. I think she's going to pick it up right now. I'll just keep going while she deals with writing down whoever is calling in, getting their info so we can get that book to them. And
will we tell their name on the air?
I don't think we will, no.
It's private.
Well, we might say something. I don't know. Let's see. Okay. Anyway, so Felicia, thank you so much for coming on the show. You are a wonderful guest and so much fun to chat with. And you have such a radiant smile. I can't wait to have you back for the next show. So thank you so much. I am Ben Woodford here with Modern Education. Coming up next, we've got DJ Scott Moulton doing Party Time. He is in the studio ready to go, and we are stoked to hear him throwing down some fresh beats for us again. We're here at Modern Education every Friday from 3 to 4 p.m. for your commute home, always talking about education, bringing in guests, and doing live shows every Friday. So thank you for tuning in. Ben Woodford with Modern Education, and I am here to tell you just a little bit about a couple of things happening around the Stanford area. The first super awesome thing I would like to tell you about is the Cheetah Conservation Fund. In the last 100 years, we have lost 90% of the world's population of cheetahs. Very sad. They are the most endangered big cat in Africa. Every day is a fight for survival. Your support for Dr. Lori Marker and the Cheetah Conservation Fund can help save these magnificent cats and communities. Your donation will allow CCF to continue its innovative research and education programs. To learn more or to donate, visit www.cheetah.org. I am equally excited to tell you about another program here, the Ecumenical Hunger Program. The Ecumenical Hunger Program was founded in 1975 by a group from Church Women United. The private, nonprofit organization located in East Palo Alto provides emergency food, clothing, case management, and household essentials to families in need in East Palo Alto, Menlo Park, and Palo Alto. To lend a helping hand or provide a much-needed donation, visit ehpcares.org or call 650-323-7781.
And here I have a promotion from KZSU. Have you ever wondered why bros don't talk about family issues, depression, or heartbreak? So have Holmes and Young Kipper, your host of Really Bro, Thursdays at 1 p.m. on KZSU. So they're going to try something crazy. Two bros talking about emotional issues where everyone can hear. That's right, spicy. Tune in for some real talk from two real bros and an insane amount of bro puns. Really, bro? Yeah, bro. Really. From 1 to 2 p.m. every Thursday afternoon on KZSU 90.1 FM or streaming at kzsu.stanford.edu/live.